Love and blessings to everyone on this beautiful California morning. I tape on the fly as I go here, so when I'm on fire, I can tape. I don't wait till I'm real tired at night to tape. This provides a little more juice, a lot more juice, actually. But last night, just before I went to bed, I had this tremendous insight. It's, wow. Okay. Don't struggle with it. Hey, let this be the new normal. So it's really important when you have the insight to trust in it. Don't go to words and labels. Emotions, words, labels. Just the wow. Okay, wow. Now I've reached this recognition. Okay? This is the new normal for me. I've reached this recognition. Once we see it, we've reached it. We've reached this recognition. Then it's just a matter of settling into it. So you don't leave it. Again, you just settle into it as much as possible. This is the key. Trust in the recognitions that you get. They are true recognitions. Trust in the path. What happened was, if I can say this, and welcome to all the viewers, thank all of the steady viewership, it helping, not only helping me, helping God, helping us all, as we go on this path of great urgency. Trusting the path. The recognitions are arising. Better late than never. It's pretty difficult to explain. When you're in the wow, it's difficult to explain. We shouldn't struggle with explanations when we're in the wow. Explanations will come later, when we're very much comfortable and established in the recognition. Then we can point out, give pointers. So I will refrain at this point from trying to explain, well, how did I come upon this recognition? I certainly did. And that's something to look forward to. I'll be able to talk about it. But I'm just feeling that it's okay not to explain. What is it that needs our explanation? Well, you say, well, others need it, yeah. But what they need to hear more than anything is it's okay not to explain. So when the recognition dawns upon them, they won't feel compelled to try to explain it. So really, it's more important to emphasize that we don't need to explain. That's a more important emphasis. Sure, there also will be explanations, but that's founded on the base of we don't need to explain. We don't need to explain. It's okay to not explain. It's okay to not explain. And sometimes that's the right move to make. This should be an emphasis, because nothing causes us to delays us worse than having a recognition and then feeling we need to explain it to everyone just so, and then struggling with the explanation and say, well, other people won't understand it, so let me see if I can do it this way or this way or this way. And we find that absurdity, the goal of absurdity, first, absurdity has to have a goal, because it's not true right now. It has no power right now. So it has to have a goal, saying, well, I will reach power. Okay, I will be true, but not now. I'm not true now, but I will be true. So it has to have a goal. And the goal of absurdity actually has to be pulling everything into absurdity. So the ego tries to pull everyone into egoic absurdity. That's all it does. So when we're trying to explain to someone who's in absurdity still loyal to absurdity, or trying to, you know, deal with that, their goal is to pull us into absurdity. That's the goal. And so we have to get this out in the open. So we're trying to struggle with explanation, but there's no explanation that satisfies absurdity. Only waiting satisfies absurdity. Only waiting, because absurdity is never satisfied now. It's a denial of now. So it has to proclaim a priori that now is not satisfying. So if it's not now, it has to wait, which of course is the belief in time. So we don't want to struggle with absurdity. Absurdity will say, oh great, you got an explanation, good, what is it? Okay. Absurdity's purpose is to not understand, is to wait for understanding. Wait, 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 wait. All it does is wait. That's it. You cannot bring the waiting of absurdity to an end. What is the walking back of absurdity? Well, it's right now. Walking it back is everything. All is the totality right now. Without even the slightest ripple in it. There's nothing at all happening to pure abstraction. The pure abstraction of totality. It never ceases to be what it is. So there's nowhere to arrive at in totality. And so there's no way to walk it back except accepting the totality is the walking back. So we gradually walk back to realizing there's no walk back because there's no way to leave it in the first place. Absurdity is not a leaving of totality. It's wishful thinking. So we gradually walk back the idea that there's a walk back. So when I use the term, we need to walk this back, this is the context, that we're walking back the whole notion that there could be any walk back at all. Nothing's ever left totality. So the walk back is always the recognition there's no step at all. There's no walk back at all required. And that's, of course, then what have to be right now without having to do anything. And you see why it's important to do this when you have the juice to do it. There's a different intensity to it. Did my exercise this morning? Good. Stretching. Jump rope. A couple hundred plus. Swinging the golf club. More stretching. And you know you're fit when you do this. It doesn't really, you don't feel too really gassed or troubled by it. And you do it every day and it's still, you still feel the same. Now you might think, well, you're not progressing. Because you said, well, before you were progressing, 10 jump rope, 50, 100, finally I got up to 500. Yeah, but the next day, I'm like, oh, I better take a couple days off. I'm really tired. But now, you know, just doing it every day, a couple hundred, every day, every day, every day, I sort of still sort of stay the same, but it's every day. So there is progress there in this way. And for instance, like this abstract teaching of totality, doing it every day, every day, every day, all during the day. Whereas before, I might like reach a work, make a great burst of effort and reach a peak of getting to this and then fall off and then years to get back to it sort of thing. Like, oh, that was such a strain. Now it's not a strain. It's a strain, but it's not too much of one. I can do it every day, bounce back from it nicely. So that is the significant progress. We tend to want to quit. I feel like, well, I can't do 500 jump ropes. I did it like a couple of weeks ago. I can't do it now so much. And I wanted to go up to 1,000. I can't do it. That's not the point. The point is to be able to give a real good effort And then the next day you still feel, you know, springy and lively and be able to give another really good effort. You don't get worn down as much. This is what's really important. Don't get worn down as much. Now, absurdity tries to wear us down. What else can it do? It tries to exhaust us. What else can it do? What else can absurdity do? And then, of course, deny that it's doing that. Because that too doesn't help absurdity. So it's absurdity always just nothing. No, not now, not now, not now, not now, not now. Okay. So the daily workouts, what that does is gradually you get used to that. And that's close to abidance, isn't it? Absurdity says that abidance will exhaust us. It says, well, you're taking all these steps at once. That must be exhausting. No, we're seeing that nothing needs to step into totality. It's already there. So why would that be exhausting? It's the end of exhaustion, actually. The end of absurdity. Absurdity is exhaustion. It's trying to get everything into totality, which has the premise that everything is not in totality right now. And that's a false premise. So absurdity is always struggling with a false premise. So you just simply drop the false premise. You don't keep the false premise and then solve the problems that the false premise presents to us. We simply drop the false premise right now. So this insight that I'm able to get to more and more normally was the insight that I got to in a supreme effort, like, I don't know, 6-5 months ago or something. I reached that in a desperation, but then I couldn't hold on to it. But now, it's just every day feeling just normal to look at it this way. So the peaks are great, but what is even better is the everyday trekking. If you trek every day, then the peaks are easy. You just say, oh yeah, I can go up that peak, no problem. And you may not even feel you need to peak anymore because you're already there. Everything is already there. What could not be of the totality? What is it that cannot be of the totality? What is it that cannot be included in the totality? The totality is simply everything that arises and doesn't arise. The pure potentiality, the pure spaciousness. So what is it that cannot be of the totality? Either the manifesting or the non-manifesting. Now, my vehicle, the oil pressure gauge stopped working. It went down to zero. And I said, oh my gosh, I have no oil pressure. I got the engine, got to get a check, got to get fixed. This is terrible. I asked the mechanic, expert mechanic, said, no, I know these vehicles, a lot of times, it's just the gauge fails. We just had a couple in here like that. It's if you run the vehicle doesn't heat up or anything, then it's just the gauge. So I decided to risk it and just drive it with a gauge on zero, and it works fine. This is the way that the world is right now. Like the gauge is going to fail. It's a good analogy. and it'll panic everybody. They'll say, oh my gosh, we have no oil pressure. It's like a panic. We got to fix it. And this has the potential to induce this panic in everybody else. This is the danger coming up. And it was very difficult for me to drive it with zero on zero. Because even though the mechanic told me that, it's still, we're so conditioned to go by measurements. If the measurement says zero, we think something must be wrong. So the world is very slick situation set up to induce panic in us. And confusion. And desperately work on fixing something. If something somehow is amiss. Well, what is missing totality? What is being missed by totality? Okay, so we can say this, and it's important to hear this, because someone right here, right now, is able to speak this way. And we know that there's a teaching that clarifies this, and we know if just our discipline and practice, working out in this way, we will eventually abide in this, and we'll accept it, this abidance of totality. We'll accept totality. So we don't want to compromise that goal. We don't want to lose sight of that goal. Now, we may not reach it right now. It's possible. Those who are listening may not reach it right now or in a month or two. Right? It's possible. But we know enough of the goal to say, well, I certainly don't want to lose my momentum towards this. That's why it's important. The world is geared up to try and bust all momentum up. We don't want to have the momentum busted up. So we take measures to sidestep the momentum busting. So we don't get induced into it, entrained into it. Collective panic is a very powerful dynamic, pseudo-dynamic. And so only those who are already completely comfortable in recognition and acceptance of totality, only that can withstand this type of pseudo-dynamic of severe panic. Only those who are already very comfortable and established in it. Those newbies who are trying to get into it, though, they're still vulnerable to it. So we're in the newbie category. We're still trying to accept it. So part of intelligence is recognizing where you're at. And we understand we're still vulnerable to it. This is why I pay attention to the warnings and the heads up I get. Even if I were to be in the totality, abiding it right now, would I be thoroughly and totally comfortable with it? So it's just become absolutely all there is without any thought otherwise. Would that really set in? Would it set in strong enough? This is the question. Maybe not. Probably not. I mean, you have some of these teachers who've been abiding in it for, long while, teaching, so absolutely comfortable it is them, without any thought of any other condition whatsoever. So if they say, that it's a trouble for us, you have to believe them. Don't believe the yoga girls, okay? They'll tell you, oh no, you could do it. We need heroes. We need to fix this situation. Oh great, you can be a hero to the world. You can be a hero to this problem. You hero to all this panic. We got to fix something. The gauge is on zero. We ran out of oil. Oh no, oil pressure. Let's dig into the engine here. Come on, there's a severe problem. You can help out. Be a hero. We will do all sorts of ceremonies for you. Lots of flowers. sing songs for you. We'll do a wonderful, you'll put you on a pedestal as a great teacher, a great guru. But just come in and fix the problem here. You know? So this is the danger. The yoga girls and their ceremonies and all of that. They're working on it. They're getting ready for it. To put these lavish welcoming ceremonies. We welcome the great teachers here to fix this problem. There is no problem. It's all pseudo pretend. Now, very interestingly, I put myself through all these ceremonies, all these grandiose ceremonies ahead of time, so I've already know what they're like, and it's like, ah, you know, been there and done that. It's not, you know, the bloom is off the rose. Ananda, my ma helped me do that. She said, put on all these ceremonies, all these flowers, do all this stuff. I said, why? She said, do it, just like as if I were coming back. Well, she didn't come back, but I went through all of this welcoming ceremony stuff. And now I'm just like, it doesn't really interest me. All the songs, all the music, all the chanting, all the flower lays and, you know, beautiful flowers and incense and staging and beautiful banners and posters and devotion and all this yoga girl stuff. I put myself through it all. It was just me. I just did it. Lavish ceremonies and all this stuff. Dressing up in the finest way, just like, wow, this is so spiritual. This is so intensely spiritual. They're all doing it to try to induce entrapment. That's what absurdity does. It wants to entrap all of us. So having been through it all already, it's just like, it doesn't, you know, the buzz is gone. The buzz is gone from all that for me. That's fire breaking. That's putting yourself through torment like that ahead of time. So when the real temptation comes, you've already taken the edge off of it. Keep in mind that this whole situation is a clever entrapment by absurdity to try and induce entrapment into everyone. This is the only goal that absurdity can have. It can't have any other goal, actually. It's not possible. And so it just works at this goal ceaselessly. And it feels it's justified. It says, well, it's fair. I mean, like, how can I have any other goal? Yeah, right. But this goal is based on a false premise. So we can have another premise. We can have a true premise. So we can switch premises. That we can do. But if we don't do that, then we will feel that we're being unfair to absurdity. Because absurdity says, I can't do anything other than this. Well, right. But we can switch premises. Absurdity cannot switch premises. It's useless to appeal to absurdity. Absurdity can't do anything. Can't switch premises. It's an effect of a false premise. Effects cannot change their cause. Of course, that's the whole absurdity. That's the whole premise that we're entertaining in the first place. So, you know, so now we're seeing it. So we have to change premises, not fix absurdity. So yeah, there's something wrong with absurdity. We need to fix it. Now, there's nothing wrong. It's just an effect from a false premise. You can't say switching premises is fixing anything within a premise. It's not. How was my golf swing today? Good, really good. Really, really good. I'm finding it more and more and more. What's the secret? turn the left shoulder back behind the ball as far as possible. Extend the arms as far as possible by keeping the left arm straight. But don't move the head. Don't rock. Don't have the head go back. Keep the head steady in place, but turn that left shoulder back behind the ball. This generates leverage, whipping leverage through the ball. That's really the secret. That is. It takes flexibility. And torque it when you're on the backswing. Torque it so the hips are torqued. But don't try to over torque. That starts getting hurting the back, hurting everything. But get some torque there. So that's core. The stronger the core is, the better you can torque like that. That's why Rory McIlroy can hit it so far. He has this tremendous hip torque and then tremendously fast release. He's not a big guy at all. I saw him, he's short, small of stature. Like 5'8", 150, 60 pounds or something. But he's able to generate a tremendous strong core. Able to get back and really torque the hips. So the swing is coming along just fine. As is this focus. Normalizing this focus. This is where we're focused. It's normal for us to be focused on this. Now, what the world wants to do is knock us off this focus and pull us into absurdity of trying to fix absurdity. That is the absurdity. It's like we're saying, well, effects are causative, but we need to fix that. We need to make it non-causative. No, we don't. It's never been causative. It never will. There's nothing to fix. So you see, we have this right focus here, right emphasis. The question is, how much longer can we sustain this in this world? Is it really possible? This is a big question. I will keep trying the best I can. And also focusing on the option of ascension. Open-minded to that. Or some sort of sidestepping. Can we keep this focus like this? Because it needs to be like this. It needs to be like this. We have to feel we can get to this focus. Now, this is what the teachers help us. They're able to sustain this focus and express themselves beautifully. It's no trouble for them at all. But that shows us it's possible. And they say, absolutely, it's possible for you. I've done it. You will do it too. But you must do it. So we have to keep trying to get to this type of focus. And we have to believe it's possible. Otherwise, we won't try it. We won't make the efforts. We have to believe it's possible. It's like playing with a great golfer. You see, oh, it's possible to hit the ball like that. I know it's possible. I'm just experiencing it. Then you say, okay, let me go to work on my swing. Let me strengthen my core. I tried to do sit-ups today. It was difficult. I tried to do push-ups today. I haven't tried those since I was young. I couldn't really do them. I couldn't do good push-ups at all. Wow, I said, wow, holy cow, that's interesting. So the question is, can we maintain this belief that it is possible to maintain this sort of focus and work out in this way, in this world? Or will we get knocked off the belief that that's even possible? It's just too difficult. If that happens, then you know, just spiraling down, free falling down into absurdity. Absurdity is saying that we need to fix absurdity. We got to stop, you know, or fix the effects from being causative. We got to prevent it or stop it or walk it back or fix it. Oh, something wrong. There's nothing wrong. And yet in this world, so much is going wrong that it's very difficult for us to focus on there's nothing wrong. Now, Sri Sri Anandamayi did it here in the 20th century with all the wars, World War I, World War II, Vietnam War, Korean War, the wars in all over the globe, actually. There were so many conflicts. She never had the slightest trouble. on realizing that everything is perfect. There's nothing that we need to do at all. So, but she said, don't use me as an example in terms of, can you do that also? Because she said she never had any karma at all, and none. So, in other words, no habits of attention, ever. Had never taken on that. Okay, so never been absurd. Never entertained absurdity. So just because a great teacher can do it doesn't mean that we can do it. Doesn't mean that at all. We have to be aware that focusing on that there's no problem at all is our difficulty. And the more problems there are, the more we feel an inducement to start trying to fix problems, believing there are problems to fix. That we have to do that first. But there's nothing we need to do first. This is the whole point of Jesus, Longchenpa, the great teachers. There's nothing we need to do first at all. And this world is all about saying we have to do this first. So it's dedicated to absurdity. This world is dedicated to absurdity. Now, it's a pragmatic situation. Even if I were able to abide in totality and felt very confident I can do it, that doesn't mean that others can do it right now. We have to be pragmatic. Where are they at? So the great teachers don't say, hey, I can do it. You should be able to do it too. They're very pragmatic. They understand that we have not settled into normalcy with this to the ultimate extent. And temptations of this world do get more severe. So they view it from a very super pragmatic position. As should we. And if we don't, the yoga girls may get their clutches on us. They get their talons on us. And we don't want that. That leads to suicide. No doubt about it. We've had many examples of that, actually. What the yoga girls say, we need a hero, a spiritual hero. We've got to fix this problem. Save the world, save us all, fix this problem. Where's the great guru who can fix the problem? We will worship and adore you. We'll put you on a pedestal. We will say you're the greatest of all gurus. We will say you're God itself. We will have great ceremonies and beautiful flowers. We will all do this all for you. And they ultimately, these figureheads, they suicide, basically. They can't find any way out of it. It's a severe trap. So our prayer should be just, God save us from the yoga girls. Absolutely. This is very, very important. Ananda, my mom helped out with this. She said, I'll be your yoga girl, okay? And then took me through all this stuff. She says, this is the stuff that the yoga girls will put you through. And you have to break the glamour of that so it no longer seems glamorous to you. But there's still the tinge of glamour to it. But it's much lessened. Much lessened. So we need to keep moving with that. No, I'm scared of Ananda Mayama because I said, I don't want to do this yoga girl thing anymore. Please, stay away. Stay away. But she was just doing that to help out, saying, look, you need to clear this up before things get real bad so you're not glamorized by it. So instead of using these other yoga girls, use me as the yoga girl. And I have no attachment to that role at all. And so when you're able to let go, you'll just let go. I won't bind you to it at all. Therein lies the effectiveness of some of these great teachers. This is a great example. So she's been showing up more and more, foreshadowing now, very strong. So I'm saying, whoa, wait a minute, you know, I don't want any more of this yoga girl stuff. No, don't want to get pulled into that. And so, but she has some role to play as far as that goes. Freeing us up from that. But it is a scary thing. It is a very scary thing. There's nothing that scares me more than being used as a figurehead for the yoga girls, and they saying they're inspiring you to fix the problems of the world. Fix the problem. There are no problems. But if you believe in problems, the yoga girls will make you the world leader. They really will. And they'll worship and adore you and all this. They'll say you could be historically the greatest being ever in this world or in the whole universe. You saved the entire universe. They'll look at that and they'll absolutely be fanatically supportive of you. And yet, they're only driving you to suicide. That this notion, you know, that I'm just irreversibly trapped. It's absurdity. So Ananda Mayama says, I'll be your yoga girl. Ditch all the others. Ditch all the others. You don't need any other. I'll be the perfect yoga girl. But then no attachment to that role whatsoever. It's only the play, the Leela of Sadhana there. But it's so audacious because you say, my gosh, the yoga girls are not going to be happy about this. Right? Because they want to choose their leaders. They feel that they have a right to choose the ones that say, okay, you're the chosen one. You got no choice. It's your destiny. And then they, you know, try to glamorize it. Cautionary tales all over the place. There's no leadership because there's no problem. There's no historicness because there's no history. They're selling you a sack full of nothing. They want you to be nothing. They say, don't worry about worship your nothingness. And then in order to get out of that nothingness, the people, unfortunately, they commit suicide. Really. It's like, I got to get out of this nothingness. I got to get away from this worshiping of nothingness. It's terrible. So, all praise to the great teachers. We ask their help. Not without trepidation. And we move on with the day here. Starting out with a tremendous push here. And that's what we need to do. Time is very short right now. Perilously short in terms of the inducements to come. So we need to be liberated in a very timely manner. Meaning to cut out the waiting. Cut out the waiting as much as possible here. All right. Keep in mind that the logic of absurdity has its own internal consistency, but it has a false premise. So the yoga girls will say, hey, if you don't help us out, you will be eternally unhappy because you'll have missed your great opportunity and you will let everybody down, so you'll never be able to be happy. And we will say, wait a minute, let's not wait a minute, let's get it right now. You're saying that if I don't sidestep absurdity, I'll be unhappy forever? That sounds very absurd. Sounds very absurd. Indeed it is. But absurdity has an internal consistency, and it's logic. So if we don't see the false premise, then we'd be intimidated by this. Say, oh my gosh, I can't sidestep this. I'll lose my opportunity. I'll be forever unhappy. And so, of course, this is insanely frightening. Eternal unhappiness. How can that which God created be eternally unhappy? Eternally unhappy. How's that possible? It's not possible. Again, what a threat game they play. We have to be happy, grateful for those who have fallen prey to this. And from their example, we've learned what not to do. So there have been some teachers that we've been aggravated about because they tried to mislead us. And they themselves were in the clutches of the yoga girls. We say, you know, to redeem them, we say, hey, you know, no, you don't have to be forever unhappy and follow that false logic, because we are blissfully happy and you helped us out. You helped us out. You helped show us what not to do, what to avoid. By setting such a bad example, we now know to avoid that. So it's very helpful. Thank you very much. This is how I'm seeing it now. So if we could have just gotten through to them like that, they might have been even more helpful. But certainly, and when you run into these ones who are in the clutches of the yoga girls, you just have to say, look, I don't think I can help you right now. But I'll help you by just recognizing the bad example you're setting and make sure I don't follow that bad example. But as far as anything other help, I'll let the heavyweights deal with this one. Let the heavyweights deal with it. Because those who are fronting for the yoga girls are very much have this powerful internal logic going, trying to become the king of absurdity. And that's only the heavyweights can deal with that. Let the heavyweights deal with that. Not us. We'll just back off and say, thanks for the lesson. Very much appreciated. Sorry you had to go through such travail to present the lesson, but, you know, it will all be redeemed as you recognize, oh, I didn't really need to do that at all. And I didn't really do anything as far as totality goes. It was all in the dwelling, never left the perfection of totality. It arises, exists, and subsides as totality. Everything arises, exists, and subsides as the totality. There's only the totality experiencing the totality. So we might think, well, it's too late to talk to those teachers. No, it's not, because their influence is still here in the world affecting us. The ones in the clutches of the yoga girl. So we can, by freeing ourselves from that right now and thanking them for their bad example, we are vastly helping them, whether they seem to be manifest or not. Wait, the last thing they want is the people to fall prey to their bad example. They don't really want that. They realize at some, deep down that, wow, I was just trying to be the king of absurdity. And the yoga girls were using me to be the, power behind the throne of absurdity. I don't really like that. I don't really like that at all. I just wasn't able to resist it. But at least some have been able to resist it. Great. I'll learn from their good example. I'll let their good example be a shining light unto me. So the weather in California, what El Nino? The El Nino's got AWOL. It's like going towards summer-like weather here. Supposed to be like next 6 days, it's supposed to be gorgeous. It's already gorgeous. Already gorgeous. And only getting better. What's wrong with being right? So we're in our cruising aspect of this video. Nice truck pulls in front of me with a big backhoe. I slow down. I got to. So we can relax a little bit from the intensity of the first 40 plus minutes. Full on intensity to begin. Read a comment from a Valley girl. Grew up as a Valley girl, means San Fernando Valley basically, and the greater LA area in general. But she said, well, what would we do but went cruising. What else could we do? She said, what else is there to do? You go cruising. So you get in your car and you just drive around. That's the great California pastime, really. But definitely in San Fernando Valley, and go to the mall, go driving around, go to fast food place, go driving around. Makes sense. What else is there to do in suburbia, really? Suburbia is like a desert. You're just isolated. I mean, they build all these tract homes out in the middle of fields, and the houses just sit there. I mean, that's all there is. There's nothing going on. You have to make your life interesting. The suburbia won't make it for you. No. You just sit there and listen to the crickets. That's it. It can really freak you out. It's a freak out, no question. My gosh. I mean, it's so different than the city or even the countryside where, at least you've got the rural aspect going for you there. You got farming life going for you. suburbia, they just, you got a basketball hoop. You know, you put a basketball hoop on your house and you know, just or practice the guitar. Or, I mean, what do? Well, a lot of people go to college. they keep themselves busy learning some profession. If you don't do that, wow. That's why people, a lot of suburbanites take drugs. Listen to music, take drugs, watch television, try to stay. Wow, they're just sitting out there in the middle of nowhere. You can only go cruising so long. So you have to be a genius to deal with suburbia. And they have to fashion a spiritual path out of suburbia. Make a lemonade out of lemons. There isn't anything else to do. Or you can just watch television, which is horrible. You know, this is what happens. And then you get moved to the retirement home and just watch television. This is what happens. You have to have a spiritual path. And you have to work at it every day. It's interesting. The challenge is interesting. You have to have this internal challenge to survive suburbia. Or some just try to be as rich as possible. That becomes their internal challenge. I tried gardening, but no. People try to be obsessed with their yard. Tried that. Too much work, too difficult, disappointing. Just try to keep changing the garden around. New flowers here, new this. I tried that. It just, wow, suburbia is just a monster of boredom. Yeah, absurdity is a challenge, isn't it? The challenge is to drop the premise behind absurdity. Instead of tilting at the windmills of trying to fix absurdity, we don't say, well, that's absurd, I need to fix it. No, what absurdity is pointing out to us is absurd. That there's something that is somehow needs to be reinstated to totality. There's nothing that needs to be reinstated or re-included. Absurdity says, oh my gosh, look at all that stuff. Look at all this stuff that's not part of totality. You really got to work at this. You know, it's that's your mission that God gave you. God sent you here to return everything to oneness, to totality. This is absurdity. I was going to take you by the Apple... new Apple headquarters, but I forgot. I took another turn up. So that means it's not that important to me, right? There's a homeless man here. Let us give him something here. Let's give him a five. How you doing, sir?
Okay, neighbor needs some help. I'm clean and sober. No drugs, no alcohol.
Okay, well, I'll pray for you that you get the help that comes to you.
All right, thank you.
Okay, you deserve it.
Bless you.
Okay, bless
you. Clean and sober.
Good for you. Wonderful. Stay that way.
One day at a time.
One day at a time. That's right.
I still got obedience and everything.
Okay, stay with it.
Huh?
Stay with it.
Oh, yeah. I'm over the hard part. It's easy now.
Awesome.
I got the urge.
Okay, well, get back on your feet. Okay.
It does work if you want it to.
You gotta want it, right?
Yep.
You don't want it, it's not gonna work.
Too many people are forced into it that aren't ready.
I got a friend that's in the same situation right now. He came to work, he couldn't be sober at work. He's gotta go into rehab, but he doesn't really want it. That's the problem. It doesn't work.
And he will eventually.
Yeah. There you go. Got it on tape. pretty awesome, huh? I don't know if you could hear that. I looked for ones. Where are the ones? I couldn't find the ones in my wallet. That's usually all I have. Where are the ones? And there was a five. I said, what the heck? Let's give him a five. I gave him a five and he's like, oh, wow. He's very surprised. Usually people give him ones. Right? We all give the homeless just ones, don't we? They say, oh, God bless. You know. But he looked at it, it's like, five? It's like, huh? And he's like, wow. So he started talking. And we were at the stoplight there. We had a conversation back and forth, right over the cars and the traffic and everything right there. And talking about, you know, he's been sober for 10 years. He says, it's the first part that's the most difficult. And if you don't get no more craving, then that's it. And he said, if you ever need some help, you know, I'm sober. See, what happens when alcohol is terrible? You lose your job. People don't trust you anymore. Can't get back on your feet. He said, you got to really want it, which is true. Which is true. You got to really want it. You really got to want truth, actually. The real sobriety is truth, is totality. You got to really want that, or you're not going to get it. And like he said, well, he will eventually. You know, I just saying, hey, you know, people, they don't necessarily want it. Well, he said, he will eventually. Yeah, truth, right? The man was speaking truth to us right there, folks. And there's a homeless man down, you know, down on his luck. He can't get back on his feet. Well, you know what? He said, yeah, one day at a time. I said, one step at a time. Yeah. Stay in the now. So I wasn't afraid to, you know, shout to him. Shout out. He was shouting back to me, shouting out. I look at people next to me, that their windows partly open. They're hearing what we're saying. Maybe it helped wake them up, right? Wow, so that's very intense. He saw the microphone too. So he's like, "What's this?" But I'm taping. I mean, I'm taping. I'm not trying to tape him, but this is just an experience that arose as I'm taping. So I say, okay, let's just let it roll and see what happens here. Problem is, when you're homeless, you look disheveled, you know, people don't trust you. And when you go through problems with alcohol, you don't have a lot of skills, you know, it ruins your life. Of course, everything here is designed to ruin your life. Ruin the true life of all-inclusive totality. That's the true spiritual life. So the world's designed to ruin that life. At least make us think that it's already been ruined and that we're here to fix it. Wow. We're the heroines and heroes that are here to fix the part of totality that has been ruined, that's no longer included in it, that's separated out. We need to return it to its pristine condition of all-inclusiveness. This is the absurdity. This is the fault. That is the falsity. And this is what we're waking up to. It's like we're blinking our eyes like, huh? That's the light? Is that easy? What? So, you give these people the benefit of the doubt. You know, are they sober? If they were really sober, would they not be getting some sort of job? Well, you know, who am I to judge that? You know, just give them some money. He says, look, I'm not giving up on you. I don't care whether you're lying or not lying. God doesn't give up on you. Plain and simple. You're already included. You've never left. They're under the delusion they left and they're failing to return. They think, I'm a failure to return. I'm a terrible failure. I got a drink to drown this awful failure. I can't find a way to return to God. We never left.
Nothing's ever left. How can anything leave the totality of all that is? So how could we fail? It's impossible to be a failure. But you know what? Jesus would have done something for him. Jesus wouldn't have given up on him. Jesus says, I know you're already whole. Go and sin no more. In other words, don't believe in sin anymore. Go and don't believe in sin anymore. I don't think I've ever given a five to a homeless person or like that. That's all I could find. I kept digging for the ones. I was running out of time. I said, I'm running out of time here because the light's going to turn green. So I couldn't find the ones. I said, forget it. Either I give him nothing or I give him the five. Gave him the five. That means I'm willing for him to dwell in the fifth dimension. And if I'm willing to give that to my brothers, then I'm willing to give it to myself. Jesus says, you receive what you give. Because how can you give it unless you have it? And what you have, you extend. You don't lose it. So I'm starting to see that. You receive what you give. Because everything you give to all. And you're included in the all. So you receive what you're giving. What you give, you receive. If you want to receive something, then give it. I've been struggling with this. What is he talking about? Because we're thinking of like material things. He's talking about truth, ideas, experiencing, and the allness, all inclusivity of the allness. So you give at all. You're giving to all. You're giving to all, and you are also of the all. So this is how you receive. You receive the awareness that you have it to give. But only by giving it, he says, you become aware that you truly have it. Because that's how God creates. God extends itself and gives all to all. And this is how God knows itself, experiences itself. So we are an extension of God. This is how creation works. Oh, man, that was intense. Yeah, but this is the time for that. I said, I got to go for it. I said, here's a guy, and here's an opportunity. Let's step up to the plate. He's included, too, in the totality. Do I have the five to give? Well, I had it in the wallet. I don't have much else in the wallet, but I had it. You know, so can we go to the fifth dimension? You know, can we purchase it? Well, I mean, we can purchase it with our clarity. Yeah, I mean, we can go there, so let's go. Don't have to worry about, well, do I have a whole bunch of other money that go somewhere else? Well, we'll worry about that later. I mean, this fifth dimension is good enough. The reduced intensity zone is good enough for us right now. Good enough to sidestep the yoga girls. We won't be too upset about missing our big opportunity to be the world savior hero. Say, well, you know, worry about that later. It's crucial to make the most of our opportunities. I have one right now. Have to get something, have to wait. Somebody has to go get something for me. So nothing I can do except wait. So what do? Turn on the radio? No. Boycotting the radio, boycotting the news, boycotting the television, boycotting movies, boycotting smartphones and Apple and all this kind of sex, drugs, rock and roll. Although I did listen to some rock and roll last night. And it was very interesting. I listen to one song and then another. It get pulled in on YouTube. And what I was doing was I was saying, okay, how do I walk this back? The song I'm listening to now, how do I walk it back to what I really want? And I found I get myself, it's very difficult. I kept getting in deeper and deeper and deeper. And finally, I was listening to Albert Collins, Stevie Ray Vaughan, and Stevie Ray Vaughan and Jimmy Vaughan. And I said, I don't want to be listening to this, you know. What? How'd I get here? What? I don't know. How do I walk this back? And I just said, how about I just click on Google for search, Google search, and poof, out of YouTube. I said, I can walk it back that way, can't I? I like that. And I realized then that everything can be walked back that way, directly. There's no process we need to go through from A to B to C to D. We just go from A to totality, from D to totality, from C to totality. We don't need to go A, B, C, D, totality. Just D, totality. So I was trying to walk it back to some other song back to something I really wanted. What I really want is the totality. And yet we go there directly. So this realization hit me just, I saw, oh wow, I could recognize the implications of this. It wasn't just some intellectual labels, but I saw the application of it. It's totally generalized in my mind. Pure abstraction there. So I said, okay, great recognition. Now this will become the new normal. We'll work on having this be the new normal. And it takes a little while just to reassure yourself you're still functional after recognizing this. Takes a little bit of reassurance here. So I'm just going about my business here, working and functioning great, better humor than ever. Meeting people with wonderful humor, and we just had a great time there. I have a ringtone on my phone that's just the old dial phone ringtone. And someone walked by me, my phone was ringing, I didn't realize it, and someone says, well, you got a rotary phone in your pocket there? What's going on? I said, no, I just use that to remind people, you know, the old days, you know, that we were actually alive back then. Were we really alive? Or, I mean, the younger generation feel that we were like prototypes, embryonic, and we're only alive during these technological times. It brought us alive. And we say, actually, no, it's kind of the opposite of that. We're less alive now. We were in the embryonic stages of being less alive, you know, more detached from totality back then. So it's a mind blower to people hear that tone. I mean, everybody blows their mind. What? What's that? Rotary phone. And then I'm talking with someone. He says, I still have a rotary phone. My dad still uses one. I got, you know, and they start talking about, oh, yeah, is it still functional? Oh, yeah, of course, it still works great. If I wanted to use it, works great. I say, see? Phone's like 60 years old. Works great. I love those rotary phones. You know, it's worked great. Wow. So if we don't blow our minds, the yoga girls will say they'll blow our minds for us. So we better blow our own minds here fast. Get used to it. Get used to it. Say, my mind's already completely blown. Completely abstract. I mean, it's completely abstract. So everything is already released than now. There's no A, B. A doesn't need to go to B to walk it back into totality, because it's already is in totality. So is B. So is C. So is D. Those are just meaningless labels, actually. I wouldn't mind listening to Longchampa, you know, in person, or whatever that means. Because this is how he talks, you know. This is what he would say. Creativity is just a label. Life is just a label, really. It doesn't have any real existence or meaning in itself at all. There's nothing that's ever not been life. So it would be very enjoyable to listen to someone like that. Really, it would for me. I'd rather do that than listen to any song on YouTube. And YouTube's got them all. Except the Beatles, they pulled those stuff. But they want to say something to wait for, folks. We're working to get the Beatles back on YouTube. Well, we've heard those songs a million times. There's bootleg recordings and live recordings and Barry stuff. So you can still hear it. But I couldn't find anything that was really worth listening to. I thought Albert Collins maybe. Wow, he's got this. He's got the capo on his Telecaster. And he picks with his thumb and his finger. With, I think just his fingernails or something. He's got the suit on, and he's, wow, he looks like this guy. He's really gonna be something. But even that wasn't worth interesting. Even Stevie Ray with him wasn't really worth listening to. Wow, I said, this stuff, oh, it was boring. Forget it. Ah. Maybe the best song on YouTube's Can't Find My Way Home, Can't Find My Way Back Home. Stevie Winwood and Eric Clapton. But that, no. I don't know if I listened to it many times, and many people have, but it's got a really nice groove. But it's not what we really want. We want to experience totality. So I said, how do I walk back this song? Where do I go from here? I look over the right area with the right side of the screen with all the other videos listed. I said, okay, what can I click on here to back out of this? I'm getting backed into a corner here. But no matter what song I click on, it backs me more and more and more. I can't find a way home. I can't find my way home. And then I realize, wait a minute. Just go directly home. Direct realization. We need to find our way home. We need to accept that we are home. We can't find a way home. We can't find a way home because we never left. Nothing ever leaves totality. Absurdity can't find its way home, but it doesn't need to. Because nothing's ever left. So what is it working for? What is absurdity working for? It's working for what? What does anything need absurdity for? To find its way home? That is the absurdity. There's nothing that tree doesn't need to find its way home. That person doesn't, that body of flesh doesn't need to find its way home. That barn doesn't need to find its way home. So what does anything need absurdity for? How can absurdity help out? Nothing needs its help. Absurdity thinks it is the way home. That's the only way we can look at it, right? If we think something needs to find its way home, we can only look at it as absurdity has to accomplish it. Because we say, we've got a problem here. I don't know how to get this home. Because nothing ever left totality. So again, this focus this type of intense focus is wonderful. It's like a workout. It's like jumping rope. So let's do another 100. And of course you feel winded and you feel the burn. But you say, that's great, because I know down the road, that 100 and this and the next 100, the next 100, the next 100, you know what? That's going to suit me well. So we're sitting here in suburbia, might as well work out. Or wherever we are, sitting in an apartment building somewhere, we might as well work out. We'll be well served by this down the road. Very well served by it. It's like people ask Noah why you're building an ark. He said, well, I'll be very well served by it down the road. They say, what are you talking about? It's funny, we were just talking about pole shifts. Someone just brought it up. I happen to be an expert on pole shifts. Studied it most of my life. And he knew all about it. He's talking about it. He says, yeah, the earth is wobbling. The moon helps the earth keep, you know, stay in orbit. And the moon's moving farther away. And eventually, the earth's going to tilt on its axis. And I say, yeah, I just hope it doesn't do it tomorrow, you know. Right? Because the melting ice caps, right? Different distribution of weight on the planet, right? Yeah. Earth is wobbling quite a bit. Okay, picking it up here, Kim. We are going to drive past the new Apple headquarters. Just to be fair. Yeah, I'm working on a smoothie here. Strawberry protein, Odwalla strawberry protein drink, a banana, a whole bunch of blueberries, a whole bunch of different mixed frozen fruit, peaches and strawberries and stuff like that, and some chocolate protein powder. Pretty good. I'm enjoying it. Breakfast was an egg and toast. Some chocolate protein drink, because I worked out in the morning, hitting the jump rope. People think they're working out if they jog a little bit. Hit the jump rope and then you'll find the teeth. You'll feel the teeth. Because you can only go so far, and you start feeling it. You say, "Wow, jogging!" You could keep schlepping along for a long time. I saw that half marathon. The people there, they didn't look like in good shape, but you can find a way to kind of keep faking it, jogging, can't you? It's good for the heart rate. Burn some calories. So we're going to be going through the belly of the beast here. Let's see if our feng shui can withstand it. Of course, there's nothing to withstand. That's the martial arts masters who are enlightened, and there's just a way to present it. People will say, okay, the master just stands there, doesn't do anything. And the people trying to attack the master just collapse because there's no resistance. And it's all mental. There's no defense. So they're only attack and only attack defenses. They cannot attack no defense. And so the master just sits there quietly, and people are running at them, screaming with swords and stuff. It doesn't do anything. And eventually they just start shaking and trembling, like having a nervous breakdown, and just then they just collapse to the ground, like unconscious or something. And the master never moves. Didn't do anything. And the master's not using some mind power to, you know, zap them or something. No, master's just dwelling in the nowness of totality. Doesn't need any defense. No defenses. You can't attack, no defenses. Nothing there to attack. So those who want to attack, they end up panicking. They can't find any way to attack. They keep looking for an opening. There's nothing there. They get frightened. They get worried. They get concerned. And their nerves, they're all, you know, in chaos. Eventually, it just overwhelms them. They collapse. And they say, Master, what is your secret? He says, no secret, no defense. Jesus says, my perfect defenselessness is my perfect safety. So we're focusing in on this. Just the very act of doing that is very profound. It means our awareness is, we're opening up to it. We're going past this grove, this undeveloped plot here. There's one area that's like completely undeveloped. And it's pretty interesting to see that. It's lovely. There's all sorts of mustard greens and greenery right now. Palm trees and olive trees, and it's just allowed to just sit there, be as it is, unimproved. People from the city, they like to get away to the mountains, like the Sierras here, and they just wander around the Sierras. It's unimproved. Nobody's done anything to any of this. Just let it be the way it is. And it gives their mind a break from their constant effort to fix the problem. Fix the problem of absurdity. Now, the absurdity is the belief there's a problem to fix. So to fix the problem of absurdity, you just drop absurdity. You drop trying to fix everything. Simultaneously. It has to be simultaneous, or else you can't drop it. You're not dropping it. You're still engaged in process of fixing something. It has to be a concurrent, simultaneous dropping. And how can that be done through effort? It can only be done through just this shift. A simple shift. It's not a big leap. It's the smallest of shifts. Oh, gotta go slow. Make haste slowly. There's a lot of material to listen to, for sure. But just put it out there, and those who are blessed to have the capacity to listen to it certainly will be helped. What else is there to do, really? But keep increasing your focus in the right place. Keep putting your play of attention where it's truly beneficial. Oh, lane closure ahead. Got a nice space here to slip into this. Oh, there are the cranes. There's Craneville. Hiya, Craneville. Look at all the cranes. can't see what's happening inside because they got this massive wall of China around the place. So, you think they're good tours to everybody? Are you kidding? You have to be like super accredited to even get near. They'll probably keep the fence up, you know. I don't know. I don't know if they're going to let anyone even see the building. They'll probably like do what some of these ultra exclusive country clubs do is in the desert. They'll push all this dirt on the perimeter and make a massive earthen wall. And on top of that earthen wall, they'll then put like a, you know, 10-foot wall or something like that, and then a bunch of trees and everything. So there's no way anybody can see in. See, what's there? Yeah, it's not for your eyes. It's for our eyes only, the privileged ones. Well, it's easy to do in the desert. You just get bulldozers, just push the sand. They excavate the golf course, like, so there's all sorts of hills and valleys and lakes and streams and waterfalls. So they move a ton of sand, more than a ton. They move massive amounts of sand. They just build landscapes that weren't there before. Before they were just flat desert. And I think sometimes they go down 30, 40, 50 feet as far as elevation changes and create features, water features, canyon features, all sorts of features. They just build them. And so they push all that extra sand around it for walls. Earthen walls, sand walls. Yes, they do. I wouldn't be surprised if they did that here. So here we go. There's the wall. What are they doing here? Well, you can start to see some superstructure above the wall. You can glimpse a little bit of superstructure. The new Apple corporate building here in Cupertino, California. Yeah. Little bits. Now I got to go right past. Okay, now we can see the building taking shape there. Actually, the main building there. Looks like about three stories above ground, three or four stories above ground. Probably a lot underground as well. This is supposed to be a modern marvel of building. Hello. Yeah. Everybody's going to be watching the Super Bowl. Not everybody. I won't. Around the nation, around a lot of places. And they're going to see this gorgeous weather. It's going to probably be like 76 degrees. I mean, it is just fabulous already here. It's just going to be sparklingly gorgeous day. And they're all freezing. And winter. And they're going to see this and say, oh my gosh, what am I doing here? Let's go out to California. We should go around where all the TV cameras are, big signs, and like, oh my gosh, the big one, earthquake is coming. It's terrible. We're so scared of the big earthquake. Oh my gosh, terrible earthquakes. Everything collapses here. It's just horrible. You don't want everybody coming out here. There's already way too many people here. But yeah, you get those people from Wisconsin, they pack up and go. Either that or to Florida, you can't blame them. So why do the guys say, well, I've been sober for 10 years, and they still look like a wino? This is the question. Maybe it stays with you. You know, once you really hit bottom, it tends to stay with you. Doesn't have to. Again, our appearance is valuing of time in terms of, does we want to keep this appearance or not? We don't have to, we're not bound by time. Process this belief, this pretense at all. Not at all. And we get to discover this. We get to find out. We get to experience this. This is what I'm looking forward to. This world here has no interest. It doesn't interest me. It's just a denial of miracles. It's a volume of time. What interest does that have? That doesn't have any interest for me anymore. It's like incredibly boring, ridiculous place. Totally ridiculous place. I just try not to pay any attention to it. But it's difficult, you know, to live and not paying any attention to your experiencing, really. It's very difficult. So there has to be a better way, even when we're here, to see the illusory nature of all this. Just so we can come here to help out. Because otherwise, who would come here to help out if you have to go through this torture? Nobody. And that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to come here to help. They're trying to pull you into absurdity, then make an example. Look how torturous it is for them. You don't want to do that. They try to scare anybody else from coming here. That's... absurdity has its ways. Absurdity thinks it's being very smart. Except for the fact that it's absurd. If it weren't absurd, it would be smart. Yeah, but it is absurd. There's nothing that needs to be helped in terms of getting back into totality. Now, certainly minds that believe their bodies need help to realize that they haven't separated from totality. They're not bodies. They're the totality. Well, that's temporary help. It's just temporary help until they drop pretending, and then help isn't needed anymore. The trouble is, you spend all your efforts trying to pretend that you're also absurdist, so they don't target you to try to lure you into absurdity. So you can say, you got to pretend you're absurd, absolutely. Yeah, so this puts a great strain on the mind, and onto my mind got around just by saying, "Well, yeah, I am absurd. I can't help it. I was just born that way." Meaning I'm not absurd, which is seen as an absurdity here. She just said, well, you know, it's really unfortunate. It's just something that occasionally it happens, and, you know, there's nothing I can do about it. And it's, oh, poor lady, she's so absurd, she's so crazy, so completely absurd, oh my gosh. But she's nice. The trouble with being rich is that you get your money's working for you. The rich people, it's the money that works for them. But in the reduced intensity zone, there's no money. And so they figure, they can draw the conclusion, well, that I can't be happy then. There's no one working for me. Nothing's working for me. Well, you don't need anyone to work for you. See, the focus there is on miracles, the miraculous. The valuing of time is greatly reduced there. Greatly reduced. So you want something, you have it. So it's your mind that's working for you there, directly, instead of working through money. And Jesus said it's very difficult for a rich person to get in the kingdom of heaven. Reduced intensity zone, we'll say. Because they only feel secure, you know, with lots of money is out there working for me. This investment, this program, we're getting rent from this, and there's no money. They freak out. Me, I've lived my whole life with no money. If that $5 bill was the last money I had on earth, I'd I'd still have to, I'd have to give it. What's the difference? Either have $5 or $0. You know, it's not a really big difference there. You know, occasionally a little money trickles in, and it trickles out just as quick. So, for me to go to a world without any money, I'd just be like normal. Say, oh yeah. I mean, I've never had any money working for me. I've never had any investments. I don't even know what that is. So a world without money, I wouldn't have the slightest problem with it. Would be no continuity problem at all for me. So the continuity problem is a bigger problem than we realize for most of us here. It really is. As Bus says, be informed, be prepared. It starts with you. Well, that's right. Quite right. I don't have anything. I don't really own anything, actually. Either. Don't own anything. Don't have any money. Don't have anything working for me. So to go to a reduced intensity zone, it would just no continuity issue really at all for me in that regard. So we just have to keep working on all the different continuity issues that we have, and we can see what a big continuity issue would be for someone who like owns a lot of property, ownership of land, property, goods, this stuff. You go to the reduced intensity zone, there's no ownership. Whatever you want is yours. Just manifest it. It's a very different scenario. There's no lack. It's so easy, you don't think of it in terms of ownership. I own this. You can't own it. I own this. Well, anyone else could have whatever they want too. So the whole principle of ownership, you know, is just very, very non-issue, really. Nobody wants to needs to take anything away from you because they can have whatever they want. As we go past these big cranes, let's give a geography lesson here. Remembering to stop behind the crosswalk. Everybody does that now in Palo Alto. Nobody's on the crosswalk because they've ticketed so many people. It's amazing. I'm just looking at everybody. Is anybody, their bumper across the crosswalk? No. No way. So people have learned. Geography lesson. Let's say, talk about mountain ranges building. Let's say the land is only lifted 1 foot every 1,000 years by earthquakes. All right? 1 foot. That's 1,000 years. We had an 89 earthquake here, Loma Prieta quake. The land lifted 4 feet up there. Went up 4 feet in one earthquake. But let's just say, very conservative, 1 foot every 1,000 years. So 10,000 years, it's 10 feet, right? In 100,000 years, it's 100 feet. In 100,000 years, it's 100 feet. In 1,000,000 years, it's 1,000 feet. Every 1,000,000 years. So in 10 million years, it's 10,000 feet. So we could easily see how these mountain ranges could be built up. I've always wondered, how in the world do they get built up? Well, you start taking large expanses of time like there, tens of millions of years. So 10 million years at 10,000 feet. In 100 million years, if it only went up one, you know, inch, a tenth of an inch every year, then you'd still have 10,000 feet, right? A tenth of a foot, a little more than an inch, tenth of a foot, let's say. And you know, 100 million years, you would still have this huge 10,000 foot rise. So, you start talking in terms of 100 million years. Stuff doesn't need to change very fast here, in order to have the cumulative effect be quite extraordinary. Of course, you have pole shifts that could build the mountains faster. It pushed up real fast. Some of these mountains look like they've been pushed up very abruptly, actually. It may not be just incremental, maybe be punctuated the geological change. The problem with earthquakes is you never can brace for them. So I don't like them. You know, hurricanes, tornadoes, you know when the season is. You say, okay, it's hurricane season. You say, oh, this is a possible one is coming, and you prepare for it and everything. But the rest of the time, you don't need to worry about it. So, yeah, it's terrible, but it seems to be more manageable. I know people from who live in those areas of hurricanes, tornadoes, they don't like, they say earthquakes are a lot worse because you can't predict, you can't brace for them, you can't prepare. You know, you're just, you never know. So we're always, for me, I'm always a little jittery here. You know, really, it's not nice living in an earthquake country. In the back of your mind, you say at any point, it could hit. And when they do hit, for a long time afterwards, it has an effect. But you're, like when I drive under freeway bridges, I get nervous. It's saying, wow, I don't want to be underneath here. The light, hurry up, the light, you know, I want the light turned green so I can get out from underneath this because, you know, it collapsed. A lot of them collapsed. Previous earthquake. So it does influence your quality of enjoyment of life. Absolutely, it does. It's subconsciously most of the time, but it's always there. So in the reduced intensity zone, no earthquakes. And it makes a huge difference, actually. And being from California, I'm looking forward to that. Really am. Because there is this underlying insecurity here about earthquakes and not, you know, just not knowing when they're going to strike. Suddenly, boom! Any moment, you never know. Like a sword hanging over you. Especially because the big one hasn't happened for a long time. And so they say the big one is coming, it's coming. My whole life I've heard the big one is coming at any time. You don't know when it's going to hit. It's going to be real. It's ready to pop. So you live your whole life under this fear of this big one. The big one, you know, the big one, it would cause a lot of problems, to say the least. Very traumatic. I don't think anybody who goes through the big earthquakes, like in South America and various places, that I don't think any of them, you know, enjoyed it and said, gee, that wasn't so bad. No, they say, wow, that was terrible. So that's the fly in the ointment out here, to say the least. So if we just remove that, just removing the threat of earthquakes or tornadoes or hurricanes, removing that threat entirely, you know, wow. I don't even know what that'd be like. It would bring about a greater sense of peace and calm, no question about it. And removing the threat of pole shifts, too. I mean, everything on this planet is vulnerable, and we feel threatened by it all. Tsunamis, you name it. People have tried to find some place that's more stable, but then you have wars. You know, there's always something here in this world. But in the reduced intensity zone, none of that stuff. None of that stuff is present. So you just feel like, wow, it just feels more secure here. Way more. I feel way more secure here. And I'm not even sure why. You know, it just permeates. The whole place just feels so secure and safe. And you, after a while, you say, you know what? I really prefer this place. Greatly prefer it. So you want to tell others about it. But you got to be careful in telling others about it because they want to pull you down to absurdity, thinking that this helps absurdity reach its goal or reach some goal. It's an absurd goal. But to absurdity, any goal, you know, you have, you know, let everyone be absurd. That's just a delaying device from absurdity. From delaying it from the realization, our realization, that it has no power at all. It's not defending anything. It has no goal. It's defending from the realization it has no goal. So you have to be careful in telling others about the reduced intensity zones. So we have to, in our mind, get prepared for a reduced intensity zone. That's part of ascension, is getting clued into it. There's no pests there, no illnesses, diseases, no upheavals. This is the direct, the death-free realm, or it could be a precursor, it could be a reduced intensity zone that prepares you for the death-free zone, where there's zero evidence at all. There's no evidence of any vulnerability at all there. That's really, everything there is, has never tasted death, and never will. In a reduced intensity zone, it might be, you know, in the distant future, so to speak. Everything, whatever possible harm, is only a potentiality, a distant potentiality, if we want to engage with it. The potential to engage with it seems to still be at least there in some way. In the death-free realm, we might not even feel that at all. I don't know. I'm not sure the difference between the two, but they are after the same. But I would suspect that most are not ready for the death-free realms, not yet. And it would probably be a reduced intensity zone for us. Get used to that first. So stuff, we could say, well, no, it hasn't, it never died, none of the stuff's ever died, but in some distant future, it's possible that it could die. We could just sort of look at it that way. In the death-free realm, we look at everything, we realize it's never going to die. Never. That's a much stronger witnessing to truth. That totality can never die. You know, it's a very strong plausible inference there. Whereas here, everything gives a plausible inference that reality can die, be harmed, you know, be no more. Parts of it can collapse and go away. Very strong delusion here. Just plausible inference that that belief grabs a hold of. So I got a lot of stuff to do here in a short time to do it. Now, one thing I can say is that maybe we all go to these reduced intensity zones after this world. But if you ascend, you don't even need to go through the death situation. But the difference is that for me, I would realize that going back to this world here to help out, I would need it more training. I need to go to the death-free realm. You don't want to come back to this world unless you're truly an enlightened master. You do not want to come back to this world to help out. So I think a lot of us in the reduced intensity zones, we think, wow, I really want to help out the people of this world. They're crying out for help. And of course, it's a trap. It's a trick. They don't see it. They come back here and they flounder again. So I would say, no. I'm not going back until I'm thoroughly, until the Holy Spirit says it's safe to go back, if I go back at all. So I think I have a different perspective on it. I'd say, okay, the reduced intensity zone, well, fine. Okay, but beyond that, there's the death-free realm, and you have to work with great spiritual teachers and really completely free yourself from any attraction to absurdity. Any curiosity and attraction to it. Otherwise, coming back to this world, you're asking for trouble. Really bad trouble. So I can't just say, well, I'll come back here and I'll make some beautiful music and that'll help everybody. And no. The yoga girls get a hold of you. You're putty in their hands. You don't come back and say, maybe I have some talent, you know, that no. You have to be thoroughly normalized to truth before it's safe to come back here. So that would be, I'd be going there with a different emphasis now. Much more conscious of what the purpose is, how it can be used, how it can be helpful, and not in a rush to get back here. And again, we'll let the Holy Spirit decide. So attach yourself to spiritual masters, the great heavyweights, and don't just, even there, you know, in the reduced intensity zone, make sure that you are working, putting your attention on ultimate liberation and abiding in it and stabilizing the abidance and getting used to it. Make sure that you're doing that. I believe we've all been in this reduced intensity zones, and we come back here and then we're like in quicksand. We get tricked by absurdity. And then we feel like we're struggling in quicksand. The more we struggle, the more we go under. And so it's a hideous experience here. We say, what went wrong? I thought I had the confidence. I thought it would be so easy. No, we underestimated it. So benefit for me of this life is to not underestimate how clever absurdity is, how clever it can be, how insane it is. And wow, gas now 207, went down two more. I happened to see that I haven't seen in a long time that oil was like $33 a barrel or something. I said, what is that, a misprint? Oh, it's a misprint. I was reading some sports article and they just had a little ticker on top of the page and it said crude oil 33 something, or whoa. That's hard to even comprehend, actually, because I remember the days it was over a dollar. I mean, $100 a barrel, like we all do. It's like a third of that now. Very odd. So maybe some of us scoff at this, say, well, I've been there before and I came back here, it didn't help me, you know. Well, we didn't have the right, you know, emphasis on it, like how to use it properly maybe, or maybe we got lazy, I don't know. But certainly recognizing the problems that of this world, what this world represents is a play of absurdity. This is a severe issue. It's not a lack of intelligence here, it's all pretense, it's the play of absurdity. So you have to be outfitted for that, very much so, before you even dare, you know, to come back here to try to help out. When I was young, I used to think of all the various things I could do to improve things. I just had thousands. Everything I looked at, I said, oh, I can make that better. I can do that better. I got this. I see a way to make this better. And just thousands and thousands and thousands nonstop. And so my mind was just overloaded by all this. How can I help fix the world? Well, you know, oh, this is not a good design. I can design this better. Or this is, oh, how foolish, you know, they like this way. Let's do it this way. But you can look at the world, you can see, if you're really sharp, you can see a way to improve almost everything. And so you get overloaded. My mind couldn't sleep. My mind was overloaded. What can I do to help the world? And seeing it in a materialistic way, that way, this drives you crazy. I mean, you can't sleep. So now what we're realizing is, by realizing that nothing is separate from being, therefore nothing is truly subject to process at all, nor any necessity, we really can have anything the way we want it always. We're not bound by any of this. So trying to improve this world is only reinforces delusion, actually. And people say, that's selfish, you're not trying to improve the world. Oh, But trying to improve the world is actually deepening self-delusion. And that's trying to get away from the true self. That's what we want to avoid. Oh, Valero's a Jeep also, 207. They don't even put up gas. That must be cash price. Oh, wow. Gas is just $1.60 in Montana. Well, anyway, I'm so detached from the news, I don't know what's going on. But something's reflecting in the gas prices. But who needs... It's a great time to be detached from this world. It's a great time to be detached and just forget about the world. Forget about improving it. We have the reduced intensity zones anyway, plus the death rate realm. What do we need to spend our time trying to fix this world? The idea of fixing is the idea of brokenness or insufficiency. Reality doesn't work that way. So it gives the wrong plausible inference to us here. Very much so. There's no fixing of reality. Nothing's broken. If we don't like the way something is, or we want to improve it, then we just had that desire and it's improved. Or it's changed, or whatever. The appearance, now it appears this way. This is the ornamentation. We don't like the ornamentation, we get something we like, directly. And we realize nothing is broken. Nothing is insufficient in itself at all. Nothing is wrong in itself. It's just a decoration of its own spaciousness. How could it be wrong? We use the body as an excuse to say, well, yeah, but everything has to serve the body properly. Well, the body itself is just a decoration of its own spaciousness. It doesn't have any real needs. It's already perfect. It's already perfectly one as the totality. So again and again and again and again and again, from every angle, we keep needing to hear this and hear this and hear this and hear this, and gradually it sinks in. Because we value time, we want it to gradually sink in. If it sank in all at once, we say, well, yeah, but where's the value of time? Where is it? What do we need to value time for, except it's a waiting? That's an absurdity. The more we see this connection, the easier it is to not value time. So we could be liberated, ultimate liberation right now. In fact, this is already the case of we are already dwelling in ultimate liberation. In fact, there's no liberation at all, ultimately, because we see we've never been not the totality, right? We never left anything, never left, never separated, nothing happened. So why do we need to be liberated from nothing? I guess that is ultimate liberation, is the liberation from the whole notion of liberation. But we want to value time a little bit, like we're so used to thinking waiting helps, waiting makes it better, that we automatically say, well, I don't need the whole thing right now. If I waited a little longer, it'd be better. So that keeps us from ultimate liberation, which is being liberated from the notion of liberation. Because we think ultimate liberation could be better if we just waited a little while, which is an absurdity, because there is no liberation. So how do we make no liberation needed better by waiting? More construction. Big crane there. Wow. That's how they get the steel up. And those cranes can reach pretty high. I don't know how they do that real high buildings, though. I think they build a platform at a certain height of the building and then put the crane up there somehow. And I don't know how they get the crane up there. Maybe they use a crane to lift a crane up there. And then the crane then lifts steel to go up to the next higher, you know, level. Something like that, I think. They sort of put the cranes on the side of the building. They have some way to do it. Pretty heavy-duty business there. What's happening to politics? I don't know. Don't care. Well, I'm focused on the reduced intensity zone, how to use it properly. And reinforcing our focus here. So really, the only thing that stands in our way is our valuing of time. And we're so accustomed to waiting, which is valuing time, to make, we think, absurdity better. I mean, pleasing absurdity, which absurdity says will make the outcome better. Of course, there's no outcome at all from absurdity. There's no outcome needed. They're so used to that we just automatically have a knee-jerk reaction. When we recognize totality, we have a knee-jerk reaction that says, okay, well, great, now I see how good it can be, and now if I wait, it'll be better. It's a knee-jerk reaction. We all have it. But at least identifying the knee-jerk reaction is a huge step in the right direction here. We used to think, no, I'll just ignore it. Maybe it'll go away. No, it doesn't go away like that. We have to bring it to full consciousness, full focus here. So our patterns of attention are on it. And see it and say, okay, I have this bad knee-jerk reaction. But just like a sneeze, if you really focus on it, you can stop it. But you really have to put your attention on it. And if you really do that, it'll just vanish. Very interesting. So this knee-jerk reaction we have, if I just wait, it'll get better. We can really focus on that too, and that should just vanish also. And we can see the temptation that those who are still in absurdity, they say, oh, you're dwelling, abiding in totality. Oh, great, but we could do it too, but we're not doing it because it's going to be actually better in a little while. We're just waiting and working on it and waiting, and it's going to be even better. And so you're going to miss out on that betterness. And so this then starts causing you concern, and then you will turn your attention away from totality because of that. So we need to see that that's a knee-jerk reaction based on trying to make absurdity better. And that those who are saying we need to wait don't recognize that. They don't recognize it. They're speaking from a standpoint of absurdity, but staying within the logical consistency of absurdity and the false premise that it has. All right, so some great progress here. A lot of driving today, which is beneficial. Gives me some time to lay down these tracks, which is really repeated emphasis. There's no greater help than repeated emphasis, which means we have to bring our mind back to it again and again and again, which is what we have to do. You know, it's one thing to bring our mind to it once, but to do it again and again and again and again and again is what we really need to do. These great teachers, they're able to do that. They weave the theme and it just keeps showing up again and again and again and again, and you just say, and it's like the beautiful jewelry. Just you're paying attention. It's, that's nice. Oh, I see. Oh, yeah, there's similarity there. And keep bringing your mind back to what's important. This is the whole key to the whole thing. Keep bringing your mind back to what we really have to focus on. It's like someone does one jump rope and they say, I can do this. I got it. I got it. I said, okay, well, you know, give me 100. No, I understand. I understand what it's all about. Yeah, but He might forget. He might forget. Oh, for you. Let's make sure you don't forget. Let's let me keep working at it. It slips away easily here. That's what the world is for. It's a very slippery place. An exceedingly slippery place. Where truth just seems to slip away. A bumper, a sticker there, decal car. Cowgirl up! That's another advertising for yoga girls. It's a different way of putting it. Cowgirl up! They're taking the lead. Cowgirls are taking the lead. Yoga girls taking the lead. They got a style of absurdity that'll really help us wait. After all, absurdity says you can't succeed if you don't wait. You can't be absurd right now. So you gotta wait for absurdity to mature and evolve. So we should always be looking for something that, you know, it gets our attention, gets us fired up for some, again, to turn our attention, our play of attention back to what we really needed to be on. And again, this world, our imprisonment, we're imprisoned by our play of attention. Invisible bars, the habits, our play of attention, our habitual play of attention, how it plays habitually, these constitute the bars of our imprisonment. Because we're not able to get our attention to what we need to really put it on. This knee-jerk reaction of saying, well, I need to wait. Oh, there's enlightenment. Yeah, okay, I'll make it even better. I'll wait a little while. It'll be even better. I'm not going to get tricked into not making it better. I'm not going to get tricked into making totality more total. Or not making it more total, rather. I'm not going to get tricked into just accepting totality. I got to make it even more total. I'll just wait. I'll make pure spaciousness even more pure spaciousness. Which is denying absoluteness, isn't it? It's denial of absoluteness. So, yep, I do need to get over here, folks. Okay. So again and again and again and again and again, we bring our mind back. The benefit of taping this way is I'm able to hit the pause button at times when the inspiration isn't quite what it needs to be. Although usually I go in long stretches here without hitting the pause button. But when I need to stop or do this or do that, I hit the pause button. And so you get like sort of a non-stop stream of inspiration. Whereas when I'm taping live, there may be more peaks and valleys. I mean, as far as in a video, no pausing. When I'm on camera, no pausing. I could do it, but, you know, this way it seems I can be more intense and produce more intense content here. And I think most people just listen to it anyway. They don't really watch the video. I mean, what's there to watch, actually? A little bit. Mannerisms, etc. So maybe, but a lot of us just listen to it anyway. This way also you have the ambient sounds. It helps us realize that we have to do this right in the flow of our day. Of course, absurdity says, wait, it'd be a lot better if you just waited until things are a lot better. Oh, I wait, okay, it'd be a lot better if I wait, but how are things going to get a lot better? By waiting, by time, absurdity tells us. Okay, well, I better hedge my bets on that. I'm gonna, but that's not really waiting. You don't trust. Not you mean you don't trust time? Not entirely. Well, that's your problem. That it says you trust the time more, everything'd be great. Well, I don't see any evidence of that actually. Well, it's because nobody's trusted time. Well, actually, the teachers say that they don't value time. That's our problem. So I need to kind of hedge my bets because I think I'm maybe dealing with absurdity here. Absurdity says, that's absurd. What are you talking about? Not dealing with absurdity? Valuing time? Of course. Of course that's what you do. Well, you would do that with logical consistency within an absurd premise, belief system based on absurd premise. That would be how it appeared to be very logical. So I think I need, before I agree to value time, I need to look at your premise here. Ah, that's absurd. It's absurd. It's absurd. Say, well, maybe, maybe not. Doesn't hurt to find out. Absurd, he doesn't like that. He says, I'm failing to teach you properly. You're a failed student. It's not my fault. You're a terrible failed student. How dare you be such a lousy student? You're insulting the teacher here. He said, well, if you're absurdity, you're not a teacher at all. And I would say, how can I be insulting a teacher? It's ridiculous. So we have, that's yet to be determined whether I'm insulting you or not. Whether there's something there to be insulted. How can you insult nothing? See, absurdity just turned a whiter shade of pale right there. Busted. Nervous. Intimidation didn't work so well that time. So this is really the only way to make this world seem tolerable, really. The spiritual path is the only way to make it tolerable, right? Yeah. Most people live lives of quiet desperation. Well, we're not so quiet about our desperation here. I wonder if we could tape like this on an airplane. We'd probably get arrested, right? Like, what is it, TSA or something? I don't know what it is, but you can't do that on an airplane. I mean, I can't talk quietly and softly like on my seat. No, you're disturbing the other passengers. Best be quiet. See? I don't know. Might not work out so well. Of course, they have these movies that you're listening to, right? Of course, you do it on, I guess you do it on headphones, or maybe not, I don't know. I've never done it. That's right, I've never watched a movie on an airplane flight. Thank God for that. You're kind of a captive audience there. Very sneaky, isn't it? Got all these movies for you, folks. How wonderful, huh? Ah, yes, I think I want to go swimming in a cesspool today. That's just what I wanted to do. Convenient that it's being offered to me. And how, here's your alcoholic drinks, folks. Drink up. Helps relieve some of the tension. After all, that's how we relieve tension as well, don't we? How we make the world tolerable. Those who don't do any of that stuff, well, they gotta be on the spiritual path to make it through. Speak up. Let your desperation be heard. Let you hear it yourself. Vocalize it. Let be aware of it. say, wow, I'm really desperate here. There's no question about it. This is a, I feel, you know, going towards a black hole here, black hole of absurdity. And I'm feeling like everybody's expecting me to march right in along with them. That's a pretty desperate situation right there. Well, everybody expected me just to be a good little boy and shut up. They really did. They insisted upon it. So I'm still pretending to be a good little boy and shutting up, but I'm not really doing that. I mean, this world, everybody's got a hammer. And if you're a nail, they see you as a nail, they're going to hammer you down. So you better have a, you know, the great gurus, you look at them. Again, Sri Sri Nandamayamah, she'd just say right out front, you know, hey, I'm sorry, but I can't always do what you asked me to do because I'm retarded. I got this problem. I got some kind of problem that, you know, is just not fixable. Of course, she got away with that back then when they, you know, didn't have genetic engineering and stuff. But nowadays they say, oh, don't worry, Bob, we'll fix it for you. Different story, right? So, oh, we got the machines now. We got the technology now to deal with you for sure. We'll just send it to UCSF or something and they'll hook you up, Mayo Clinic or whatever, and we'll delve into it. We'll really delve into it. She's going to say, well, I just seem to have a non-compliant spirit. I was just, you know, born that way, so I can't really go along with that. And I say, well, we'll help you go along with it. Not quite as easy these days, I would say. Back then, people shrugged their shoulders, and they used to say, oh, well, nothing anybody can do about it, so, you know, that's that. Maybe they'll say, well, we'll partner you up. You're a special needs child. We'll partner you up with a buddy. And, you know, that'll help you out. You'll learn how to proper patterns of socialization and be in response. Reaction, stimulus, reaction, response. We'll learn all the proper ways to do it here. I say, hey, can I be her buddy? Yeah, I volunteer. The buddy of a special needs. Uh-oh. Police, 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 police. Yeah. I think I'll volunteer, but I'm just helping out this special needs person that really need a lot of help. It may take a while. Do it that way these days. Yes, sir. Okay, there's some nice spiritual humor, but there's a lot of truth to it. Or maybe, I think the gurus might be in the world as special needs children right now. They need to buddy up with them. I don't know, that's a possibility, really. Some of these autistic kids, special needs kids, seem to have, you know, great insight, spiritual insight. Seem to. But I think a real spiritual teacher would know how to function here just fine. I wouldn't have any problem with it, actually. They would find a way. But it's not inconceivable. They could be labeled as a special needs child. And all that entails these days. It's like, oh my gosh, you mean somebody doesn't know how to embrace absurdity? Oh my God, this is terrible. I really need to help these people. maybe we need to listen to them, you know? Possible. We kind of need to multitask and have this, what we're doing here is the most important aspect of multitasking. So as you go about your absurd existence, life existence, dance absurdity, you multitask and go about your dance of non-absurdity. Otherwise, absurdity will just eat us for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. We don't want to be eaten up by absurdity. Not at all. Why would we want that? Whoops. Okay. I'm going to start hitting some traffic here, which is not good because I have some time deadlines here. Well, what can we do? Do the best we can. Getting out here closer to Super Bowl territory, and there's not a sign at all that there's a Super Bowl taking place here in 2 days' time. You wouldn't know it at all. Pretty amazing. It's not like Metropolis, where there's massive skyscrapers where they put the plaster, the big billboards everywhere. This is all very spread out here, and The only sign I've seen is on buses, where the buses say Super Bowl 50, you know, that little LED display. That's it. But other than that, no indication. Haven't seen any VIPs yet. I know if you went down near the stadium, you know, and hung out at the Hyatt or something, you'd probably see a lot of people. In fact, for sure you would. Although I think most of the big wigs are in San Francisco. They prefer the ambience there. Now, this is a little strange. I seem to be behind the same car I was driving earlier, and it's like been about a half an hour. I went, you know, way out in the boondocks here and there and getting stuff, going in a different direction now. I mean, that's just impossible, but those license plate, Texas license plate, see, it seems like the same car. I can't, it's inconceivable. Maybe there are a lot of people from Texas here. Maybe they're here for the Super Bowl. Why would they drive out from Texas? The Cowboys are not in it. Well, it's football. Hmm. 206, interesting. Wonder what this means. Maybe Texas symbolizes also a reduced intensity zone of some sort. Came from it, now we're going back to it. So that's why the car was in front of me on the way, now it's in front of me on the way back. Yeah, there's less bureaucracy in Texas, isn't there? You could call that a reduced intensity zone place in some ways. Less government. More freedom. More freedom in Texas. Want to call it that. So this is a theory here I have that maybe Holy Spirit's pointing out something to me. It's a white vehicle, a beautiful white vehicle. We all assume here that bodies have all these needs and that's not true. Everyone projects needs upon the body, and the fact that everybody does it here we make this assumption that this is true, and it's not true at all. So we can be here with a body and not identify with it at all, and not project any needs on it at all, actually. And this is what the teachers do, great teachers. They show up with the body, but the body, they never identify with it at all. And they don't project, they only project upon it what pretense that some people say, oh, okay, you know, a little bit of pretense, they say, okay. But they can remove that pretense at any moment, at any instant. That's why Jesus projected the pretense of death upon his body. And then he just removed that pretense. It's that simple. And he said, you can do the same thing. Everyone can do the same thing. We can literally remove all pretense from this body. And the body, he says, it will function absolutely flawlessly. Will not age, will not suffer, will not be sick or hurt or anything. If we want that. But he says, most people probably say, hey, you know, let's, don't really want that. But we can do that. He says, we don't want to have a body associated with us for a long, long time. But whenever we do, we can have one. And as long as we want, we can have one in flawless, perfect condition, never changing. This is his testimony. This is the testimony of the great teacher, Jesus Christ. How many are listening to that? It's very important. We make this assumption just because everybody chooses not to do that and they decide to project upon the body that the body is this way. It's not. It's, as Jesus said, it's neutral. I sidestepped some of the traffic. I was looking at the freeway. It was absolutely packed and the on-ramps backed up. I mean, it was just a horror show. So I'm going surface streets right here, and I believe this is going to save me a lot of time. We will see. The Friday commute is going full throttle now. There's an old Oldsmobile, classic country club Oldsmobile type of car. Those are the days, huh? Not really. There are no days, there are no phases in this world that are the good old days, actually. Not at all. I've gone back and I looked and I said, nah, it was terrible back then. It's terrible now, too. Probably worse. Given the slickness of it all. But we were trying to, everyone was trying to be pretty slick back then, too. Slickness is always in play here, but never more so than now. That is for sure. Okay. Wow. People are in a hurry to get home. That's for sure. Still hit the stoplight. Got through this one. Speeded, but he goes speeding, just roaring past me. You might have heard the sound. And they guys are stopped at a red light up ahead. I missed. I got caught at this light, but they got caught at this one. I'm now I'm caught up to them. So, see, don't play beat the stoplight like that. Just multitask and focus on truth. Shift sector. I like that. Little decal, shift sector. We're in the shifts, part of the shift sector. Yeah, a little shift is all we need. Just a little shift, we can work it out. We can make this whole damn thing work out. Just a little shift. Dun, 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 dun. That's all it takes, just a little shift. Little shift in emphasis. Meter on. I think I'm going to hit the traffic here, but we sidestep like a half an hour or more of nightmare. No doubt about it. Well, actually, the traffic's moving well. We really did a brilliant thing right there. And it just came to me. I said, I just thinking, of course I got to take the freeway. I said, wait a minute. This is like cuts across like the hypotenuse of a triangle. And this is going to save a lot of time. And it has just been wonderful. Look at this. Beautiful. No trouble at all. Good. Someone let me in. Nice Range Rover let me in. People are behaving themselves these days a little bit. There's a Prius that cheated. Zoomed up towards the exit there, then cut across the white lines and got into this lane by doing it that way. There's a Weaver there, no question, that Prius. One of the hot rod Prius drivers. Trade the storehouse of advice that I've gotten for all the money in the world, not even all the money in the universe, wouldn't even think of trading it, and it would not even, you know, I wouldn't even hesitate. There's no way in the world I'm going to trade that in. If you don't have this advice, all the money in the world is going to be nothing but a millstone around your neck. It's going to be terrible. And if you have this advice, why would you want all that money? You wouldn't want it anyway. So, as Jesus said, go after the pearl of great price. You know, go after the real great advice here. That's your treasure. Lay up your treasure in the reduced intensity zone by preparing for the reduced intensity zone. This is what you should do. Don't try to lay up your treasure here. That's really stupid. That is that these times right now that we live in actually have been ideal, maybe the best times ever spiritually, the best opportunity ever, because we have translations now from all of the great traditions throughout history. We have access to all these translations and books. And so we can steep ourselves in this tremendous helpfulness. Not only that, we had tremendous teachers in the 20th century here. Some of the greatest spiritual teachers this planet has ever seen were right here in this world in the 20th century. So you put that together, and you know, we have pictures of them. We have video of them. In the past, they didn't have that, right? So the access that we have is just tremendous. And so we are able to steep ourselves in that. We're able to steep ourselves in that if we simply take this opportunity. And I've absolutely maximized this opportunity. So maybe this is the reason I came here, is to set up future effectiveness, is to use this time to maximum effect. I certainly have done just that. My whole life, that's all I've done, really. Just been steeped in the best information available. What a great advantage this generation, this time has had. From multiple sources, you can just point out many, but you can point out A Course in Miracles, for instance, which is just a completely extraordinarily helpful advice. tremendously helpful advice. You know, in English, we could read it, go to the bookstore, just buy it, take it home, study it for 30 years, 40 years. And it's a time when we haven't had any particular stranglehold on ideology, so we're kind of free to believe what we want to believe and do that. It's probably going to change very soon. You didn't have the church saying, well, this is, you know, anathema, you can't read this, you can't think this way, etc. You didn't have secular society so strong that they outlawed that, although it's getting that way now, where you're labeled mentally crazy if you look at that stuff and just pay attention to it. So we had this wonderful opportunity to, you know, saint-making sort of opportunity here in this world. Wow. So I'm just realizing my great good fortune. You come across the original teachings by Longchenpa in English, translated very ably. You know, we can't say there's any one perfect translation of it, but it's, you know, it's conveyed. It's conveyed very well. How great is that? You could order it from Nepal. Comes by airmail. You can spend your time with that. You got people like on YouTube sharing this information. How cool is that? So we have this stellar opportunity. We have had this. That's all likely to come to an end now. We had this great, great, great push with the urgency. That also helps, this urgency, as we see everything going downhill into this absurdist black hole, actually. This puts us under pressure, which is a great thing. So you talk about a great combination of factors. This is it. So as bad as this time was, I can look back on it somewhat fondly as saying that, you know, it helped me get the job done. Like living in suburbia. There's nothing else to do. Might as well lead a monastic life and just stay in my room and study. Not really missing anything. The music going bad helped me a lot. I said, forget it. I'm not going to follow music anymore. That was very, very helpful. So sometimes, you know, negative stuff can be very helpful to those who use it in the right way. They can use it to break habits, whatever their habits have been. And when it goes bad, you just say, I can't follow that habit anymore. It's just terrible. The music is just too wretched. I cannot be part of it anymore. I have to cut off association with that. And then that gave me all my time could be spent on focusing on great spiritual advice. Super helpful. So we may be looking at, you know, something really great that's happened. Now, it was a blessing in disguise. I mean, we couldn't really enjoy ourselves here. But there was work that had to be done. You got to get down to it at some point. So it was conducive to doing the tough work that needed to get done these times. So what a great blessing. A lot of blessings. We need to count our blessings and make the most of the opportunity. Unfortunately, I don't believe that, you know, I don't know how many have maximized their opportunity here. I've tried to encourage people to do just that. I said, the time is short. You really have to get after it right now, maximize the opportunity. And hopefully a lot have done just that. There's a hummingbird there feeding off of these beautiful flowers that are blooming. Fruit tree flowers, and hummingbirds just going all day, probably going to town. So let's keep maximizing this opportunity. Go, keep going for it. You know, we just have abundance of riches right now for those who are willing to do this. And, you know, very soon the absurdity may just try to produce as much confusion as possible to, so that we all feel that absurdity is the right track to go on. That's what absurdity tries to do. That's what it's focused on. And it's relentless about that. So that would not be a surprise at all. However, the progress that's already been made may be sufficient. At least speaking for myself, may be sufficient, actually, to get over the difficult part of it and really go to a reduced intensity zone. Understanding the purpose of it all, the direction of it all, and the wisdom of it. We'll find out soon.